us on the block. Running down these lines, I got it on lock. Like Bam by the Planet Rock. Talk about life with a hard knock. Numb from the value of the shot. Fuck it, I'ma post it all on TikTok. Tie lid with a black star say. When I'm most deaf like a guy seen bae.
Yeah, yeah, we are here. We are back. Yes. Galloway and Hendo. Like we never left, man. What's up, good bro?
Nah, what's going on?
Not much, man. I forewarned you ahead of time. Man, I'm just keeping that buzz alive, man. How about this, bro? Mm-hmm. You know, I dropped that song, I guess it was 2 weeks ago. Man, everybody literally is showing me love, man. The numbers keep going up. You know, I want to thank y'all, man, oh, man. South Africa, Italy, Canada. Man, I want to thank y'all, man. So I said, hey, let me keep that going. You know, I got an EP coming out the end of the month. We'll talk about it. Y'all stay tuned. But, man, today I feel like we talking sports and hip-hop. Sports and hip-hop. It's this one young lady in particular, man. Mm-hmm. Didn't they play yesterday?
Played last night.
Yeah, last night. Unfortunately, they lost, man. Yeah. I don't want to mess up her name, man. But I think this young female is phenomenal, man. The reason I fell in love with her is her backstory about her dad, you know, and her against all odds, man. Y'all might be asking, who are we talking about, man? Who are we talking about? And I do not want to mess her name up, so let me go.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm confused. Like, I didn't know if you was going to play a clip. I thought you was jumping to a clip. I'm sorry. Her name is Flau'jae.
Flau'jae. But because you said that, let's jump into a clip.
Hooping when the rap game is going on.
Everybody think I just started hooping and rapping out of nowhere. I've been doing this my whole life.
We really changing the narrative of what you can be in basketball, how you can act, what you can do. And I think that a lot of young girls seeing this, like, I can really just be myself.
These kids, because they seeing something like they never seen before. They were like, she rap and she play basketball and she go to school.
Cool,
like,
word.
Yes.
They like, I could do that. I could do anything.
Flau'jae. Man, I had to say her name a couple times, man. Very unique name. I want to say this, man, before we go on any further. Mm-hmm. In the past, man, we've been noted to say, oh, man, where's hip-hop going? The young people, the young people, the young people, the young people. I'm no longer going to say that, man, because they're all out here doing that thing. Mm-hmm. And then I looked at it like this, man. I really sat back and gave this a hard thought. Mm-hmm. We first started listening to hip-hop, right? Mm-hmm. I want to say Melly Mel and those guys. You know, they didn't sound like Run DMC.
Right.
We got used to Run DMC. Run DMC didn't sound like Eric Van Rakim. You know what I mean? Public Enemy. The list goes on. NWA, forget about it. Jay-Z, Biggie, all the way up to a Drake. It's just evolving, man. You know what I mean? Maybe a lot of it we're not meant to get. What's your thoughts on that?
I mean, you know how I feel about today's rap. Mm-hmm. It's not for me. But I really like this young lady. Mm-hmm. Really like this young lady. I guess we'll get into the other side of it later. But for me, I actually listened to some of her music, mm-hmm. knowing that we were doing this. I listened to some of her music, and I will say, for the most part, she sounds like most of the rappers today. And that's not saying that's a bad thing, but she sounds, you know, same cadence, same flow, you know, same music, same style, the auto-tune and all that stuff. But there was a track that I did like.
Mm.
It was only like a minute long, mm-hmm. and it's called LSU.
Mm.
And, you know, it was about her and the team and everything. Mm-hmm. And I give her, you know, even though, like I say, to me, music isn't what it used to be. You still got some clever people out there, you know, that say some slick stuff. She said something that resonated with me a little bit, and I'm like, oh, you're a little clever little chick. She said, I block them like Jenny. Now, that could mean three different things. That could mean I block them, like I'm blocking out all the noise from the haters because they was like, you can't rap and play basketball.
Right.
Or she could have meant I block them, like on a basketball court.
Mm-hmm.
Or she could have meant Jenny from the block.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, you know what, you was a little clever. You clever. You got me with that one. But you know what I mean? Like she flows like the young kids today. And to me, a lot of people, especially last year, they kind of thought it was just like a gimmick or a fad.
Mm-hmm.
But the little girl can hoop. I'm sorry, the young lady can hoop.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And she can rap. And she can rap as well. Mm-hmm. It ain't all for me, but she can rap. She can do both of them. And I think, personally, especially with the NIL deals, which is the name, image, and likeness that came up in college sports, which allows these athletes to make money off of their own name. Because mm-hmm. before, in the past, you couldn't make money off your name. Like, if you were a student athlete, you mm-hmm. couldn't even get a part-time job. Mm-hmm. So, you could be going to the University of Maryland and be the best basketball player in the country, so to speak, right?
Mm-hmm.
University selling out every game, your jerseys all over the country. You were sitting in the dorm eating oodles and noodles like everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
Hungry because you ain't got no money, because you can't get a part-time job.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? I don't understand why they can't get a part-time job. I mean, right. Like, yo, I need to eat. Especially these guys that are burning a lot of calories, doing a lot of movement. They need to eat because they're bigger guys and they're burning energy. So, you know what I'm saying? For this to come around, I think this also gave her that push to do something outside of the realm of basketball. And I'm glad for all of these student athletes, because now they get to make money. And one of the bigger things is, not only do they get to make money, they take care of their teammates.
Mm.
You know, I see my man Reg in here. What's going on, Reg? I hate UConn. I hate the University of Connecticut.
Mm.
But I like Paige Beckers, and she's the young lady that's, I think, is the best college basketball player right now.
Mm.
But when she got her deal, like, she was one of the first ones to get an NIL deal. When she got her deal, she took care of all her teammates.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So not only does it affect the ones that are actually stars, it benefits the teams and other people, because now they have money to, when them kids get hungry, they can go get some food, or they can go out to eat, or mm-hmm. when they want to do something, they can actually do it. And Flau'jae out there doing her thing. Like, she's, as a young female basketball star, she's making money because she's worth over $1 million.
Mm. And that's dope. Speaking of which, man, first of all, you dropped a lot of gems, man. For all the young people out here listening, you know, one of the things I like about her as well is she's multifaceted. You know, we grew up, man, you know, our lovers, our parents and all, they just wanted us to go somewhere and be gainfully employed to take care of ourselves, right?
20 years pension.
Exactly.
But all that stuff, yep.
Yeah. But I feel like these young people, man, they move to a beat of their own drum, man, and she's definitely one. Who says you can rap and play basketball? We won't get into a backstory, but man, I want to jump ahead because you mentioned it, and I want to highlight it, man. She has endorsement deals, like you said, with the likes of Puma,
Meta,
Bell, Kane.
Deal with Meta.
Yeah, which is amazing, man. Because like you said, man, college life. Shout out to my nephew, man. He's graduating this year, but man, college life is real, man. Because mm-hmm. how are you going to focus on your studies and be mindful of that, you know, and juggle a work like that, you know? You know, with the workplace, man, it's all or nothing.
Right.
When you punch in, they want 100% of your time. And another thing that I did not know or didn't realize, man, in the women's WNBA, I guess mm-hmm. that's what it's called.
Yeah.
I didn't know that they were getting paid around $200.
That's some of the top ones.
Player, right?
That's some of the top players. They're getting paid around $200. If that much.
I'm picking your brain because this is your forte here. What do the bench players get in the NBA?
I mean, I'm not really familiar with their salaries as much, but you have some of them in there making $60,000, $70,000 a year.
Really?
Yes.
Wow. Because last I checked, March Madness is big. Last I checked, the NBA is forget about. You get what I'm saying?
But that's the NBA, and that was March Madness. Up until last year, ironically, with Flau'jae and LSU. I think the LSU-Iowa matchup last year turned the tide for women's college basketball and made it a little more prevalent than it is. Mm-hmm. And I think they had the most watched game. I know they got 9.9 million views last year on that women's college basketball game. Mm-hmm. The most ever. And I think the rivalry between Angel Reese and Caitlin Clark, I think that propelled it. And I think, especially if Angel decides to go into the WNBA this year, it's going to be, and I've said this before, a Magic Bird type situation going into the NBA. So it's going to turn the tide. I think that they're going to make more money. They did 12.3 yesterday. Yeah. Yo, listen, it's a turn. We as sports fans, and a lot of us like Brodney and I, Jose, we don't really care too much for men's college basketball anymore. The women's game is, yo, when I say this last 2 weeks, especially this last week and a half, I've been sitting here watching every women's college basketball game that came on. What's up, Yolanda? That came on. I watched every one. The only men's basketball games I watched was actually Duke. And that's because Duke is my team. So outside of that, nah. And Flau'jae had a lot to do with that change. But I think if the WNBA is actually going to get where it needs to be, I think it has to. There have to be a movement by women to support the WNBA. To be quite honest with you, because even last year with LSU and Iowa, you saw a lot of sexism going on. You saw a lot of grown men hurling slurs and just nastiness towards young ladies, and a lot of them just can't accept. You know, the old guard can't accept the new guard. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, except for when I was working with me. The old guard can't accept the new. They don't like the new. They don't like the change. They don't like seeing women in the forefront. Because some men still, unfortunately, have that belief that women can't do the things that men can do. So I think for the WNBA to take its rightful place where it deserves to be and where it needs to be, because they have some good games in the WNBA. I think women need to come support them a little bit more. Because right now, the men just aren't going to do it. Now, there may be a shift because of what's happening in college basketball, but yeah, we'll see. And definitely with Caitlin Clark going to the WNBA, there's going to be an uptick in sales, uptick in television deals and all that. So the more that they make in the television deals, the more the players are going to get per se. Not as much as they deserve, but they're going to get a little bit more.
That's dope, man. That's dope. And I'm super excited about it. And I'm going to get more involved as well, man. Y'all might ask, man, why does she rap? I'm going to tell you why. Because of her dad. Believe it or not, her dad was an MC. Rest in peace, man. Check this out real quick, bro.
Say hey, la mama, what's your name? I'ma get straight to the point. I ain't with no games.
Everybody was about to be straight, not only financially, but career-wise. But May 19th came.
On May 19th, rapper Camouflage was gunned
down. It was
the
worst. It was still to this day probably the saddest day in Savannah. The saddest.
Camouflage friends and fans stunned.
Now this saddens me, man. But unfortunately, man, this is also familiar in our community, in our culture. You know, at the time, she was 6 months. Well, she was, her mom was pregnant with her. And he was in the studio, laying music down. It was gunned down at the studio. You know, it saddens me. It breaks my heart, right? So here you got now a single mom, right? They're in the hood. They got to make a way out of nowhere. And she had the foresight to keep moving. How many times have you seen TV shows or documentaries? And they'll say something to the extent of, which I hate this, but they'll say, I ain't having fun. Well, I ain't had no male role model in the house. So how am I going to achieve? How am I going to be successful? How am I going to do this? How am I going to do that? She's an example of perseverance, of going by that. Now, granted, I am blessed to still have my father. And I had him my entire life. Not only was my dad a role model to me, he was a role model to all of my friends in the community. So I was blessed to have that. So I don't know nothing about not having a father, right? But I do see and have saw examples of people that didn't have a dad around, and they still persevered and got through. Now, I know it's not easy. It's not easy for any of us.
Right.
But, man, I salute her for that alone, because that alone could have made her giving up. You know, that could have put her in a form of depression, a state of depression, I should say. But she kept going. I digress, because I could babble on and on and on about that. You know what I'm saying? I didn't know that Bootsy, on the low, was checking on her, making sure she was good. You know, sometimes, you know, I said this last week, man. Where the rappers when things happen? You know, where are they in the community? I need to take that back, too. I just need to educate myself and do more research. Because there are, like you said last week, there are people out there doing things, but they don't always want it to be highlighted. So maybe I need to re-change my way of thinking with that. You know what I mean? Well, I thought that was dope. I never heard his music until now. I didn't really hear him before now. But, you know, he was a major inspiration in her rapping. So she's truly a student of the game, man. Did you know, bro, that she was on America's Got Talent?
Mm-hmm.
That was dope, man. And also, I watched this, man, but I guess I only watched the first season of the Jermaine Dupri show.
The Rap Game?
The Rap Game. And I remember Mulatto, but I don't remember her. I think she was in season 3. You know, but she's been doing this rap thing for a minute, man. And I applaud her for that. Did you see that particular episode or that season that she was on?
I've never watched that show.
Yeah. I like that Jermaine. I don't know. I'm going to say this. I like Jermaine Dupri. When the show came out, to be honest, I'm like, why is he always focusing on these young
people?
What's
up, Jose? I don't think they can hear us. I think we low. I don't know. Am I low? Jose? I don't know. Am I low? I don't know. Dre, you do sound a little low. I thought it was my headphones.
Got you. I don't know if it's testing. How about now? Testing.
Sounds the same to me.
Got you. I don't know. I lost my train of thought.
You talking about the Rap Game?
Yeah. At first, right? With Jermaine Dupri, I'm like, man, you know, why don't he get young adults and do what they got to do? But now I realize after listening to Flau'jae talk about it, it takes years to develop that. And I guess that's what Jermaine Dupri niche is developing talent, because I don't think they do that anymore. I think it's, you know, hey, if you out there hot, they just keep it going, keep that momentum going. Well, you know, maybe that's it. Hey, let's look at it. Michael Jackson, he started young. Your favorite artist, Usher, he started young.
Who?
Usher, baby. Man, oh, man.
I turned my volume up. I don't know if it's working. Man.
LSU, check this book.
Close finish as the number 3 seed LSU defeats number 2 UCLA 78-69. Flau'jae Johnson, her energy, her spirit, her fire, first half offensively an explosion. In the second half, came up with a huge block. She finished with 24 points, 12 rebounds, 2 blocks. How big has Flau'jae been for LSU?
You kind of already was talking about her and her talent, man. One thing mm-hmm. that I think is super dope, man, is, like, I haven't been following the NBA or any sport for a minute now, but my favorite athlete in the NBA at this very moment is LeBron, right? Mm-hmm. Before that, obviously, it was Jordan. You know, some people would say Jordan is one of the best of all times, but the man, best. What LeBron has done and accomplished amazing. Is amazing. It's absolutely amazing. You know what I mean? And I foresee this happening with her. I guess I might be prematurely saying it, but man, to be so laser focused at such a young age, I don't see how that cannot happen for her. What's your thoughts?
Well, to take it back to when you were talking about the two-parent household. I didn't grow up in a two-parent household. I never knew my father. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when people say I didn't have a father, you also have to take a look at, did they have a strong mother? Mm. Because a lot of times when you see these people succeeding, it's because they had that mother that played dual roles. Mm-hmm. And if they weren't strong, a lot of them faltered. But if they were strong, some of them made it through. I think along with her having a strong mother and the fact that she actually rapped to continue her father's legacy, I think that's one thing that keeps her laser focused. Now, looking at her father's name, if you look at her father's name, camouflage, right? Mm-hmm. Look at the flage part, but change the G to a J and put an A in it, and you got Flau'jae. Mm-hmm. So I think all that is dedicated to her father, but once again, it's hard to have focus and want to kind of thrive in one area, but she was also a McDonald's All-American, which means she was one of the best women's basketball players in the country in 2022. Then in 2023, which was last year, she won a national championship with LSU as a freshman. And watching her play this year, I actually saw her take a leap. Like, last year, she's a freshman. She did her thing. She was still pretty good. But a lot of people were like, yo, you a rapper and a basketball player? Really? But this season, she took kind of a leadership role. And I know LSU, for the most part, was about Angel Reese. But Flau'jae did her thing this year. And especially if, you know, Angel decides to go to the WNBA, she's going to be at the forefront of LSU. And her talent is going to really shine on the basketball court. But yeah, you know, she can do it both. She can do whatever she wants to do. And she's proven that she can because she's already done it.
Facts.
You know what I mean? So, shout out to her. Like, I really like this young lady. You know, I don't like much. Mm-hmm. And I don't like many people.
That's a fact. Both facts.
But yeah, I like this young lady. Like, she's doing her thing and she's thriving at both. Mm-hmm. You know, her production deal with Rock Nation.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Her NIL deals. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, do you like she's 20 years old and already worth $1 million and she's not even out of college yet. Right. So this kind of breaks that trope that our parents had with, man, you just got to get to 9 to 5 that's steady and is going to employ you till you retire. Mm-hmm. It's not the way of the world anymore. Yeah. It's not how the world works. And she's one of the ones that grasped. I think she's one of the young ladies that have the highest deal NIL deals. Mm. So somebody believed in her.
Right.
And I think that it actually paid off.
Yeah. And I think that's dope too, man. I looked at her history too when she first started playing basketball, right? Her mm-hmm. uncles was like, man, let her. Her mom was like, you want to play ball? And her uncles was like, yeah, let her play. But she started out there playing with the little boys in the street. You know what I mean? Playing against them.
You got to.
Yeah. And it shows that she went out there, did a thing. Honed his skills, man, I think is super dope, man. Speaking of honing skills, man, check out this quick freestyle she spit.
You scared to make diamonds up out of pressure, put 100 on their head, it's about time they gotta respect us. I really need a 10 if I'm signing, ain't nothing less of my mind, it gotta be special, my grind is just so excessive. They be talking down, but I don't ever let it get to me. Came to LSU my freshman year and we made history.
That's the LSU one.
Yes. Man, how about this? Sometimes we do these shows, man, I want to play more. I don't understand why it's such a big deal. Why they won't let us be great.
It's not a you thing, particularly. It's because some people will take that and just play her whole video to get views and make money off it. Mm-hmm. It's not that they'll use a clip and be like, look, we talking about this young lady and we trying to promote her and give her flowers. All they're going to do is just run her video and hope people see it and be like, all right, oh, that's her video. Click, 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 click. Mm-hmm. So they're trying to make money off of other people's things, and YouTube is trying to cut down on that. Plus, YouTube is kind of a dictator, so, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Well, that makes sense, man. Yo, I wanted to do the hip-hop report, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's so much Diddy bash. All of that stuff, man. I don't want to be the place to do that.
You need to get on board, sir.
Get
on board. Look, Jump on that train.
We could talk about it, but not talk about it. Because I feel like this, right? Man, I know that his sons are involved. And you know how I feel about kids.
Of course.
You know what I mean? I think that's a little whack. Yes, they are young adults. They ran their kids' age, right?
Yep.
So I get that too, man. But you know, he got daughters. Man, I just think, man, how about this, bro? I'm going to say this. Everybody wants to be a detective. This is what burns me up about the whole Diddy situation. Now everybody is solving the case. Everybody's going back. And you know what's funny? People take clips. Like, I saw a clip off topic, but on topic. They had a clip about Beyonce, right? Beyonce was really talking about Solange and a boyfriend she had back in the day when Solange was, you know how kids are, I guess, especially siblings. You know, they want to be hugged up under their older sibling.
Right.
And she had a little boyfriend, and obviously Solange was mad. So Solange had told her dad a fib that, hey, this boy was assaulting her, and it got messy. But they spent the narrative as if Beyonce was talking about her and Hove in a relationship. Quarrel. Stemming it all with this Diddy stuff. So that's what I don't like. Everybody chopping up bits and pieces and controlling this narrative. Hey, I'm not feeling what he did. Hey, I don't know what he did. But this is somebody's life. And the victims. That's their lives too. Let the proper people do their job and solve the case and let justice be done.
Right. But is it, to an extent, is it not your job to report what's going on in hip-hop?
It is.
Isn't that what you chose to do?
I concur.
And I'm not saying that you got to be messy about it, but you decided you wanted to just to do a channel about news, but yet still you want to shy away from bad news. You only want to talk about the good news. But when it comes to the bad stuff, it's like, I don't want to touch it. Is that reporting the news, or is that is that reporting a perspective?
It's definitely reporting a perspective. I will agree to that, and I am guilty of that. But man, I feel like, man, as a culture, as a people, we already down each other enough, man.
But you can report it without downing them. You can tell how you feel. And you can report the stuff like you just said. People are trying to spin a Beyonce thing and are making it look like it's something it's not by putting the truth out there. That's how you help the situation instead of saying, yo, I'm just going to keep quiet about anything.
Well, let me ask you this about the Diddy. What's your thoughts on
him? What's my thoughts on him? Yo, you already know me. I've been saying he cruddy. I've been saying, yo, I think he had something to do with Biggie getting killed. Like, yo, like, certain people with certain egos. And I'm not saying everything that they say about him is true, but you can tell and feel he did something dirty. Regardless if they told half the story, the whole truth, or whatever it was, you can tell. Like, yo, this dude, and this always bothered me, this dude is a black man, went on TV, went on out in media, and had a black servant, and thought that shit was cool. And thought that was popping and made him look like a man. And, you know, I mean, shout out to Farnsworth Bentley, I guess. You know, everybody need a job, but where's your self-dignity? You know what I'm saying?
Well, how about I'm going to go there? I was not, I swear on everything. I wasn't planning on going there. I am going to go there. Diddy wouldn't be who he was if it wasn't for us. Yes. Not you and I, the culture. Who, hey, Diddy can't perform a show and get millions if we don't go.
Yes, he can.
How can he?
How?
Yes. Answer
so,
that.
So I got a riddle for you. How did Hammer get so high and fall? Mm. Wasn't because of us. Mm. Wasn't because of the culture. Mm. Yeah, you know I'm telling the truth. You're trying to silence me. Mm. Black me out. It wasn't because of the. It wasn't because of us or the culture. Mm. It's because certain other people started going to his concerts, buying his albums. And then at the same time, it turned around and bit him in the behind and was his downfall because it wasn't us. Mm. So, yes, that's how you become popular. That's how you become a millionaire and become powerful without us or the culture, because we don't pull the strings. Mm. Mm. We invent things all the time that we have no master controls over. Mm. They control the narrative. Okay. They control how it's pushed out in the world.
Well, riddle me this. The Diddy parties. Everybody. And anybody wanted to go to these parties. And yo, up until the pandemic, I ain't hear nobody complaining about these parties.
Because but now. Because here's the thing. You and I go to a Diddy party, right? Mm-hmm. Me and you going to Diddy party to push our channel. Mm-hmm. To hobnob with certain people, see if we can get some numbers, get somebody behind us, you know what I'm saying? Get funding or whatever. We, you know, we drink a couple drinks, have a couple laughs, and we bounce. Hmm. We don't know nothing about what's going on in that back room. Hmm. So now, of course, we didn't have a problem with it because we didn't know nothing about it. Now, we heard some things, but we didn't physically see it with our own eyes. So why are we going to come out and be like, yeah, now I got a problem with it? Because we never knew. We just went there to make connections. Hmm. Just like you throw a house party, you don't know everybody that's going to show up. Hmm. Just because you invited a bunch of people, you know some people going to bring some people that's going to bring some people. Mm-hmm. You don't know all of these people. Mm-hmm. So you're not held responsible for the company that company brings. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So not everybody knew what was going on. Now, there were certain people that knew, yo, we going up in here because of Diddy party. Mm. Yeah, man. Mm. But of course, also, when a lot of people get caught, they love to play the victim role. Because they feel like it absolves them of, you know what I'm saying, any moral obligations. Mm. Like, oh, I can't believe this is going on. Bro, you was at every party. Mm. And you was the last one to leave. Mm. Don't tell me you didn't know nothing.
Right. Speaking of victims, and this is the last thing I got to say about it, right? If somebody assaults you as an adult, I get as a kid, I even get as a young adult, but as a grown man or woman, why is it challenging to say something at that moment or to leave and have that conversation with authorities?
Why?
Yes.
Because the narrative that has been spun for the longest time in the black community, especially amongst black men, yo, even to this day, we can't even say something slightly off without somebody being paused. Mm. So as a grown black man who is supposed to be the most manly of men, the most masculine out there, how can they go out to an authority and say, yo, I got drugged at this party and I was raped? Mm. You know what I'm saying? Of course, you want to tell somebody that, but then on top of that, not only do I have to go before these people and say, yo, I've been raped, they're going to want me to go before a grand jury and say this out in the open. I was watching Quiet on the Set, and that's the little Nickelodeon joint. Shout out to Drake Bell, because he came and told his whole story. And I lied to you not, I got up and clapped. Because for him to be a grown man and say, yo, this man did things to me that no one should have ever done to another person. For him to express his pain to the world like that, that's a hard thing to do. And in the black community, even amongst our black women, you know what I'm saying? Black women always say they want a man that shows emotion and has a softer side. But soon as we do, it's like, yo, you saw, you gay? You know what I'm saying? So we've been conditioned to hold everything in and just be the strength that carries the weight of the world on our shoulders. So a lot of us have not yet transitioned to being able to say, yo, I've been assaulted. You need to do something about this. Mm. We, as black men, have always been told, hold it in. Keep it down. Because, yo, I'm this, for instance, I'm this boxer. I'm this big, I'm this bruising boxer. Everybody think I'm the baddest man on the planet, mm-hmm. per se, right? Mm-hmm. How do I go before the world and say I've been raped? Mm-hmm. And especially in today's climate with social media, all they're going to do is make jokes about it. Mm-hmm. So now, at the expense of the world, I'm entertainment on the wrong side. And as you know as well as I know, the male ego, especially the black male ego, is one of the most fragile things on this planet. Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, it's hard. Like, yo, it's hard. It's hard for us as people that have known each other for 40 years to look at another grown man and be like, yo, I love you, bro. Yo, you looking good today. You out here killing them. You know what I'm saying? We can't even do that. So how am I supposed to get in front of a camera and a bunch of TV and be like, yo, they took advantage of me. Unwillingly. You know what I'm saying? And this is the last thing I'm going to say about this. I was watching an episode a long time ago of SVU. And something happened. And I think it was this guy. It was this guy was going around raping men. And the police went up and was like, yeah. Went to the hospital and was like, yo, I heard you were getting raped. You know, I heard you were one of the victims. And we want to get a statement. And the guy was like, I can't do it. And he was like, why, you know, you've been assaulted by this guy who's been doing this. Why can't you say anything? He was like, because in the midst of it, I got aroused. To put it in certain words. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. His soul just stood at attention. And they tried to explain to him, like, yo, it's in essence, regardless of what happened, it's sex. So that happens. And he was like, yo, what if he tells somebody that happened? People are going to think that I enjoyed it. You know what I'm saying? So just that shame and that guilt made this man say, yo, I just got raped, but I ain't saying a word. So, it's a delicate thing. That's why a lot of people don't speak about it when it happens, even with children. Like, sometimes children are made, or even adults are made to think it was their fault. You know what I'm saying? And then that shame and that guilt is too much for them. And then, like, once again, just to think of, you done went through this traumatic experience, right? You have been taken advantage of in this traumatic experience. In this situation, they may have video evidence of this. Not only that, you have to worry about getting in front of your wife and your kids and them seeing you in this position. And in your mind, you just thinking, yo, my kids aren't going to respect me anymore. My wife's not going to want me. My friends are going to make fun of me and laugh at me, even though those things probably won't happen. These are thoughts that are going through your head, and it's kind of hard to get it out your head. So you have to go through the trauma of the actual incident and the consequences of you coming out.
Wow. You unpacked a lot, man. And I definitely see your perspective, man. I just fear that we had so many examples, and this is definitely not a teachable moment. When I see this Diddy thing, I see clickbait. I see, like you said, the immaturity in people and the jokes. I don't see it as a teachable moment. R. Kelly, I didn't see it as a teachable moment. Your boy Russell Simmons, Bill Cosby, the list goes on and on and on. So I just wrestle with the why. Now, I do see that is dope for a prosecutor, somebody, to have this on their resume. I took down Diddy. I took down Cosby, etc. But I don't see the teachable moment in the culture.
And that's why it's your responsibility to talk about it in a responsible and respectful way. That's why I challenge you at. Like, your whole thing is you want to be messy. I don't want to be messy, but I've told you before, you could tastefully talk about things. And it doesn't always have to be about slander. You can tell your side or the way that you feel about it. Like, everybody has a different perspective on it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? You can tell a Diddy story without making jokes. You can talk about R. Kelly without trying to make it comical. You be the anti-society and you tell it in a way that people say, yo, I didn't think about it like that. You know what I'm saying? This ain't funny. This ain't a laughing matter.
Right.
Because, once again, news or not, if your job or you choose a profession where you want to talk about the news, you got to talk about the good and the bad. in my opinion, you can't pick and choose between, well, yo, I'm only just do Sunshine and Rainbows. Mm. And when something bad come up, I'm just going to mention it and be like, hey, we ain't talking about it today.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm guilty of it, man, but I'm glad that we had this conversation, man.
And that's the thing. It's, you learn. Sometimes you learn different things by having a conversation. And not once did we sit there and make a joke or say, yo, did he this and did he do that? Not once did we do that, but we had a conversation about it. Like I said, it doesn't have to be dirty. It doesn't have to be messy. You can have an intelligent conversation about anything. It's just how, it's just the way that you choose to present it to people. And facts. What you actually want to talk about.
Facts. Facts. Well said. Well put, man. I guess we're about to get up out of here, man. I don't think there's nothing left to say after that, bro. Oh, how about this? Until next time, y'all. Be safe. Be blessed.